this is Lee back once again for another video, and in my last video that I was speaking about the TNA Knockouts division, I left out some very important things. Now, I know I said that, you know, the years 2007 to 2009 were the best. I really was speaking generally about TNA as a whole. But in reality, you know, I kind of misspoke there because, you know, if you look back at the overall TNA product, I mean, yes, you do have fans that say, well, you know, back when they were in the Asylum, you know, arena, and they were doing weekly pay-per-views, you know, with the four-sided ring with the yellow robes, and that was their best. I've seen, you know, some of that, and certainly they were, you know, a young upstart company at that time, you know, fresh off the death of WCW and all that sort of thing. But really, I think the golden age, you know, when I really, you know, just couldn't wait to see what they were going to do, was from 2005 onward, just because, you know, they had, you know, that was the height of the X Division, you know, and the Best of the X Division 2-volume DVD set, which I should review one of these days. It's, you know, incredible. Really made me love that company and watching their shows, you know, and it makes me so sad that they've fallen on hard times in recent years. But anyway, so from 2005 onward, but you know, the Knockouts division, you know, the women wrestlers really didn't get started until around 2007 that they really took off, you know. And there were some wrestlers I didn't even mention, you know, quite an oversight. Alyssa Flash, also known as Cheerleader Melissa, which is the name and character she debuted on TNA, was actually in 2008. She also played Raisha Saeed, which, you know, very stereotypical, you know, Middle Eastern, you know, character. But nevertheless, she's great moves, great fighting spirit. You know, not the best promos in the world, but I think she just, I was very proud of her. And I was very sad that I sort of missed, you know, when it was on week after week on television, you know, to watch, you know, these live, you know, shows where she would, you know, strut her stuff, you know. And she starts out kind of as this character, kind of this tease, but, you know, she had the thick eye makeup, and she had the, later she had the kind of raccoon, you know, makeup design, which, you know, Jessica Havoc kind of used. But anyway, Alyssa Flash, great character, great wrestler. She's just been consistently, you know, always a hard worker throughout. Roxy Laveau, also known as Nikki Rox, you know, outside of TNA, you know, the Voodoo Queen. She was also known as Roxy, the Hardcore Knockout. Great wrestler, very charismatic. The story goes that she got fired from TNA because, and this is Wikipedia, so who knows the veracity of this story, but apparently Rock Khan, you know, this very tall, you know, woman wrestler, was apparently, you know, sniffing people in the ring. She was hitting too hard, and Nikki Rox, you know, got mad at her. They got into a scuffle backstage, and she was kicked out for fighting, you know, for real. So, I don't know, I guess I have some respect for her, you know, for standing up for principles and the spirit of wrestling, assuming that story's true, of course, even if she acted in an unprofessional manner. You can't be attacking people on the job. But nevertheless, you know, Nikki Rox, Roxy Laveau, very good. Daphne! Now, this is kind of a sad story. Daphne was, you know, treated badly, and she maintains to this day, you know, the TNA really treated her badly. She was injured several times when she was thrown onto barbed wire in a match with Abyss, which, you know, it's a spot, it's a wrestling spot. It's not like other wrestlers don't take those kind of hits, but apparently she was got a concussion because she landed wrong, and she felt that it, you know, was an unsafe spot. And of course, by spot, I mean, you know, the stunt that they do. The other issue was that Rosie Lavlove, who now wrestles as Andrea, you know, she was this very large woman, and people kind of bashed her. They said, well, you know, she's just, they just make fun of her because she's fat, and, you know, that she was just sort of a Caucasian version of Awesome Kong when Awesome Kong had left, because, you know, Awesome Kong, you know, broke the nose of Bubba the Love Sponge, you know, because he had said, You'd made fun of her because she cried when, you know, victims of Haiti and you know, when that was going on. Anyway, I just all those backstage shenanigans. But, you know, these are real people with real feelings and personalities. And, you know, things don't always work out in a storybook fashion. But anyway, was such a great wrestler. I mean, she was, you know, a personality back in the WCW days. And, you know, she was a backstage, you know, not backstage, a valet, you know, side character. But she really came into her own TNA, you know, was to the world. You know, she wrestled in many independent promotions, but she was zombie hot, you know, she was kind of this mean girl. She was quite, you know, an attractive, you know, woman. But she made her face, you know, scrunched up and just fierce and screaming and grimacing. And, you know, I can greatly respect, you know, any modern Western woman who's willing to make herself ugly for the sake of her craft, and she really did it. And she was always, you know, playing fun-loving, kind of mischievous characters. But in TNA, she was really a fierce, you know, fighter, very vicious, and I really appreciated her character. But the other incident was, you know, Rosie Lavalove had sat on her chest, and apparently she landed badly, and, you know, because you're not really supposed to put all your weight on a person's ribs like that, and she broke her ribs. So she was injured twice there. You know, Daphne has had this kind of back and forth with TNA trying to fight for, you know, the rights of wrestlers. You know, there's this ongoing problem. Wrestlers are treated as independent contractors, and yet they're sort of restricted in so many ways that it's just not fair to the performers. They're kind of used up and, you know, chewed up and spit out by these companies. You know, you're demanded to, you know, take all these risks, and then when you get injured, it's kind of like, well, goodbye. We're not going to help you anymore. So, you know, it's some of it you could say, well, the wrestlers do it to themselves, why do they take these crazy risks? But at the same time, you know, the companies push them into these things and really don't really help them much of the time. So it's unfortunate. But that's another rant for another day. I mean, Daphne, what a legend. And she pretty much seems to have retired from active wrestling as of yet, but, you know, she does do valet, and she does announcing, so it's good to see her doing that. But anyway, Daphne, big part of the division at the time, even though it was, you know, kind of accident-prone and, you know, unfortunate for her livelihood and her life, but nevertheless, you know, it was a joy to see her and her characters in the ring and so forth. Taylor Wilde, known as Chantel Taylor outside of TNA, a great wrestler, not as memorable as some of the other characters in my opinion, but you know, she was certainly quality, and she appeared in Shimmer. So, you know, when I first got into Shimmer, I was like, there's so many wrestlers here that I recognize, because they're TNA, and they weren't allowed to do as much on the big television screen as they did in some of these independent promotions, but nevertheless, you could tell that they are talented. You could tell that even when they had bad matches, it was because they were being held back by the writers, you know, the television personalities behind the scenes, and not because they had really done anything wrong. You know, everyone has a bad match now and then, everyone botches a move, but these are very talented and professional female athletes, I would say. Who else? So, Nikki Rocks, Daphne, Taylor Wilde, Winter, known as Nikita, you know, briefly, she had this, she was briefly in Shimmer. She had kind of an interesting character, but it was one of these sort of faux lesbian, you know, I'm getting hypnotized. I don't know why they go back to this storyline so often in wrestling. I guess it all started with Mickie James and Trish Stratus, or maybe it was Sable and that other woman. It's like, you've got the female wrestler, and then you've got the creepy stalker that wants to molest her. And, you know, you had male wrestlers like that, like Goldust, and it's sort of like, well, you know, you've got a physical wrestling altercation, and what if one of the wrestlers, you know, gets a thrill out of, you know, manhandling the other person, you know, in kind of a perverse way? And so it kind of adds some interesting psychology to the match. It's like, well, I want to get up and wrestle them, but, you know, I'm afraid because they're going to get too close to me and creep me out. So, you know, it was okay, but I really feel like they could have used her in a better way. But, you know, once again, it was good to see her. Sarita, Sam Stock, of course, you know, a decent wrestler, you know, attractive young woman. I don't know if she was really used to her utmost in either promotion, whether Shimmer or TNA, but, you know, once again, it was good to see her. She was part of Mexican America, which was a shoddy ripoff of a very decent tag team, LAX. You know, you could say it was stereotypical, you know, these Hispanic gangsters. But, you know, much of wrestling is stereotypes, ripoff characters. You know, some of the most famous characters are ripoffs. Sting, you know, for one, Ric Flair, so many others. Hulk Hogan, perhaps, you know. So many wrestlers are really, they're copying other wrestlers who are copying pop culture, movie, comic book, you know, characters, you know, things like that. So wrestling draws inspiration from all over the place. But anyway, you know, you had some great wrestlers in there. You know, and even though I was not a big fan of the beautiful people, you know, the kind of the mean girls, you know, sex appeal, trashy, you know, characters, nevertheless, they were a good foil for some of the other wrestlers that I previously mentioned, you know, Awesome Kong, Gail Kim, and all the others. I think the great thing about the heyday of the Knockouts division from about 2007 to 2009, but I should extend it because 2009 was the year that Hamada, Yaka Hamada got in there. And she was in there just for such a short time, I think about a year to 2010. And that was about the time that Alyssa Flash left. And, you know, there's several other wrestlers. You know, they came back for maybe like one more match, that was it. And they were kind of wasted. Whoever was in management at that time, and I'm not going to name names, but, you know, people behind the scenes really destroyed the Knockouts division. They really ruined it. And it seemed like they had this very diverse cast of, you know, very unique, interesting characters. And that's what I liked about Shimmer, you know, for so many of its years, is that they treated women's wrestling with respect. There's this idea that, you know, Japan does this as well. It's like, we don't have, you know, the male wrestlers, which we know they're the real wrestlers. They're the real show. And then we have the sideshow attraction over here that these women, oh, and they're pretty, and ooh, they're going to pretend to fight, and yeah, whatever, now let's get to the real. No, you treat the women as part of the show. They're fully-fledged wrestlers. They're demonstrated to be tough and strong. You know, if someone attacks them, they're not going to just kind of, you know, crawl away whimpering. They're not just going to slap someone in the face and try to pull their hair and, you know, call them, you know, names. They're actually going to fight just like a male wrestler would. And you have a cast of characters. You know, you have so many different personalities. You have so many different looks. You know, unique costumes. They aren't just a bunch of bikini models. They aren't, you know, there's this sort of stereotype that, you know, the Divas division at WWE for such a long time was, you know, all these women, they're all the same height, they all have the same hairstyle, they have the same physique, the same outfit pretty much. And the only thing that's different is their hair color and their, you know, ethnicity. And they all go by just, you know, their first name, and they're just all models, and they're just treated like, you know, they're just no big deal. They're really not, they're just eye candy, they're not wrestlers. And so TNA has gone back and forth between treating the women pretty much like that to treating them like actual wrestlers. It's sort of like you took a Shimmer and you put it in on television. That's kind of like what it was. You know, the matches were shorter, the storylines were a little more adult-oriented, but, you know, overall it was, you know, it was daring, it was good. It was quality entertainment. And people were watching it, I think, not just because, oh, here's some, you know, good-looking women on television. It's like they actually had, you know, good matches. You know, Serena Deeb was in there for a while. Leva Bates made a couple of appearances. And later on, you know, you had a few others. You know, you had Toxin. They couldn't get her name right. That was Christina Von Eary. You know, you just had, you know, many... women who, you know, they wrestled and they did a great job. It was kind of like, you know, just a renaissance. I mean, you hadn't seen women's wrestling this great in the United States on television since, you know, WCW and WWF, you know, took a risk and, you know, brought in Medusa. They had, you know, Bull Nakano and Aja Kong and, you know, those great Joshi performers. You know, in these very, very short matches that were not worthy of what they used to be doing, but, you know, the Crush Gals, Jumpy Bomb Angels, They gave us a taste that, you know, women's wrestling could really be something good, something special, something equal, if not greater. You know, it's like the cruiserweights, you know, watching those you know, luchadors and, you know, X Division, you know, the really high-flying, acrobatic male wrestlers, but sort of just like the female version of that. And they're not just doing moves, you know, they have personality and characters. When they're allowed to flourish, they really did a great job. So, I just wanted to, you know, kind of acknowledge, you know, those different quality, you know, performers. And really, you know, if you look back, yes, the 2007 to 2009, but also to 2010, 2011, around that time, you know, they were just letting so many go. There were so few women in the Knockouts division. It was like, if you wanted to have a battle royal, you could have the entire division in one ring at a time. It was really sad. It was really dull. And, you know, they did the storylines were just terrible. And, you know, in recent years, they brought in, you know, Marty Bell and Mia Yim and Allison Kay. And, you know, they've tried to bring in more independent women. Yes, Jessica Havoc was there briefly. She had a nice feud with Awesome Kong. Before Awesome Kong, you know, kind of disappeared again. And I don't know if she's retired or close to it, but, you know, you could see that Awesome Kong, you know, in some of her matches, she just had trouble moving. It looks like her back was injured. And, you know, you could tell she was trying not to, you know, do as much as she did in the past. But she was just such a force, such a powerful character. And, you know, you watch independent wrestling, you see Awesome Kong, Amazing Kong, rather, doing her promos, and she just, you know, just was a bully, and she just loud and just yelled. She did a fine job. In TNA, they made her kind of a monster that she could just, she would either never speak, or she would just kind of, like, groan, and you know, just, like, sing. I've rambled on, but their, you know, overall pay-per-view thing, but Knockouts at the best. Unfortunately, there's no real DVD set that does them justice like the best of the X Division does for the other attraction TNA implement history. There have been a couple of DVD sets, but you can tell by the packaging and kind of how they promoted, you know, I've watched bits and pieces, they really don't take the division very seriously. They still assume that the only reason the audience is watching is to, you know, oogle and, you know, stare at their bodies rather than watch, you know, a quality wrestling match, and they just don't know what they're doing. Whoever put them together did a terrible job. They should just showcase, you know, the good matches. I mean, yes, there's some promotional material talking about how scary Awesome Kong is and who's going to stop her. Gail King's going to step up. You know, that's fine, building the storyline, but they just really haven't put together a good collection of the best matches from, you know, the Knockouts history on TNA. So it's really too bad. You can find so many matches online, many of them on TNA Impact's, you know, own web channel on YouTube. Many of them are abbreviated, but they have some free matches and so forth. And yes, there are the TNA One Night Only Knockouts Knockdown pay-per-view specials, which you could almost consider, you know, TNA versus Shimmer, because there's so many of those wrestlers, but you can tell that they, you know, give the Shimmer, you know, the newcomers, they just let them job to the others. But there's some good moments, some good matches. You can tell that there's chemistry, especially when, you know, you've got someone on who's been on Shimmer for a long time, and they, there's someone that they've wrestled before, but, you know, no one on TNA knows who the heck they are. And they come in and it's like, ah, chemistry, you know, this is cool, but, you know, unfortunately the announcers usually ruin it. You know, Taz with his inane commentary, you know, botchamania. But anyway, you know, the TNA Impact Knockouts, you know, whatever you want to call them, they just don't get enough credit. But really, they were just the gem within the TNA product. And I wish they would go back to those glory days, but I don't think it'll ever happen unless you get people, you know, behind the scenes that care. I don't think Hulk Hogan and Eric Bischoff and even Vince Russo really knew what they had, and they just kind of threw it away, and it's really, really too bad. And they did pretty much the same thing with the X Division. I mean, we don't watch wrestling to be shocked every week, and, you know, these matches we'd never want to watch again. We don't just want to see celebrities making cameos. We actually want to see quality, you know, impactful, you know, exciting wrestling matches. We want to see great characters. We want to see great storylines that make you care about the outcome of matches, not just swerving for the sake of swerving. And we want to see these wrestlers honored and treated with respect and dignity. We want to see their careers honored. We want to see them, you know, let go with, you know, with dignity and not just, you know, throw them away as soon as they get injured, and not treat them with, you know, respect that's due. But that's kind of a problem with wrestling in general. I think these companies, you know, they just don't realize what they have until it's too late. But anyway, that's pretty much the Knockouts division. I mean, you can watch it today and catch some, you know, Shimmer veterans on the big screen, or the small screen, rather. But it's just not what it once was. You know, go on YouTube and look up Alyssa Flash, Shimada, Awesome Kong, Gail Kim, and you'll see some good matches. But not all of it was great, and there was just kind of a magical time when it just really was great. And I could just ramble on and on. But those are my thoughts. So.